Okay, well, welcome back, folks. We are into the study of popular music between the 1950s and 60s. And we have, for the last 4 or 5 weeks, we've been doing a study of how we got to that period of time. So let's get into it. We're going to start talking about the year 1954 today. We won't get through it, but let's get us started with a little music to kind of get us awake. Okay, so as I always do, we start out with our session with a trivia question. And today's trivia question is a pretty good one. Although Elvis Presley's first hit record was That's All Right, Mama, it was an old Arthur Crudup Jumps blues song. What was the name of his first recording? Okay, the answer is Elvis's first record was an acetate recording of My Happiness that he recorded on July the 18th, 1953, as a birthday gift for his mother. By the way, that record sold about 7 years ago to a musician by the name of Jack White at auction for $300,000, the original acetate. I thought I'd play that for you. I want you to listen to it because you can. All you're going to hear is Elvis singing and strumming on his guitar. And you can tell he's just I believe he was only about 18 or 19 when he made this. And very simple. You can tell he wasn't the polished singer that he would become. Shadows me.
My happiness.
Okay, well, as you can tell, the voice was there, but it was pretty rough. Definitely had not been trained yet. The guitar playing was very elementary, to say the least. He only knew about three chords. Elvis was never a great musician, per se, as far as instrumental musician. He could play the piano, he could play the guitar, but they actually were more props than they were anything else to him. So what we're going to do, this is how we're going to do this. Every year, we're going to do the same format. And we're going to start this out today. We're going to be talking about 1954. And I kind of call that how Elvis invented rock and roll. Now, he didn't invent rock and roll. And rock and roll kind of came about through a gradual process. But if anybody had anything more to do with it than he did, I don't know who it would be. So what we're going to do, we're going to concentrate totally today and probably next week on Elvis in 1954. Let's kind of review real fast what we talked about. We began our study of popular music in the 50s and 60s by looking at the baby boomer generation and how music of that era gave us an insight into the development of the social, political, economic ideas that dominated American society for the past 50 years. That's kind of the historical reason we need to look at this. We're actually looking at it just because it's fun. But, you know, we got to play a little history here. In the following weeks, we traced the development of popular music in the 19th century from Stephen Foster through the minstrel shows in vaudeville. We then saw how in the early 20th century, Broadway show tunes, ragtime, jazz, and swing music dominated the music scene, primarily among the white listening audience, while at the same time, the Black community was developing the blues and rhythm and blues. And then we looked at how the early 1950s, there were four genres of music, folk, country, gospel, and rhythm and blues fused together, kind of came together to create what we now call rock and roll. At the same time, remember, they maintain their separate identity. So when we do this, we're not going to be just talking about rock and roll. We're going to be talking about folk music. We're going to be talking about country music. We're going to be talking about rhythm and blues. I don't really talk as much about gospel music because I think most of us were as familiar with that as anything. We looked at the social, economic, and technological environment advances that enabled rock and roll to develop. And finally, we looked at some of the important figures that were instrumental in the development of rock and roll. And these included Alan Freed and Sam Phillips, nationally known DJs, record producers, songwriters, all of whose careers kind of spanned that, you know, 15-year period that we're going to be talking about here for the next several months. So let's kind of set the stage. What was going on in 1954? Now, I imagine many of you out there remember what was going on in 1954. Better than me. I was a 7-year-old kid in 1954. But I can remember this stuff. Senator Joe McCarthy was censured. You might remember the McCarthy hearings. Brown versus Board of Education in segregation in schools. That was an extremely important development because with the ending of segregation in schools, you begin to see society integrated, which is one of the key elements of bringing about the music of the 50s and 60s and the change. Remember, 1954 was the year we first exploded our first nuclear bomb. We had exploded the atomic bomb already, but this was a nuclear bomb over the little atoll in South Pacific called Bikini. Yes, that's where they got the name for the swimsuit. Ellis Island closed as a point of immigration. Up to that point, for about the past 80 years or so, all immigrants from Europe had been coming through Ellis Island, and that had finally outlived its usefulness, and it had closed. Of course, now it's a tourist attraction. The words "under God" are added to the Pledge of Allegiance. A lot of people don't realize that that was not in the original Pledge of Allegiance. It was only added in 1954 at the behest, I'm pretty sure, of President Eisenhower. Swanson introduces the first TV dinners. Boy, I've had my share of Swanson TV dinners. I don't know about you. By the way, the first one was turkey and mashed potatoes and gravy. Marilyn Monroe married Joe DiMaggio, probably the love of her life and definitely the love of Joe DiMaggio's life. The Salk vaccine is first distributed to combat polio. The first successful kidney transplant takes place. The first issues of Sports Illustrated and Playboy magazine are published. By the way, if you don't know, the first centerfold for Playboy magazine was the above mentioned Marilyn Monroe. Oprah Winfrey, John Travolta, and Al Roker were born in 1954. Henri Matisse, the great impressionist painter, post-impressionist painter, Russell Stover, one of my wife's favorite people, and Alan Turing, usually called the father of the computer, all died in that year. Popular movies, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, On the Waterfront, White Christmas. TV shows that were very big hits then, Father Knows Best, The Lone Ranger, Superman, I Love Lucy, well, I remember all of these. The Lord of the Flies was a very big best-selling book by William Golding. Peyton Place by Grace Natalia is quite the scandalous book. And Fellowship of the Rings by Tolkien were bestsellers. So that kind of sets the stage, kind of helps you remember back what was going on in 1954. So what were the big songs of 1954? We're going to look at generally what are considered to be the top 10 hits in 1954. Okay. First of all, Tony Bennett, Stranger in Paradise.
Oh.
Number 9, Perry Como, Wanted. The Four Aces, Three Coins in the Fountain. I know some of you remember that. Rosemary Clooney, Mambo Italiano. Eddie Fisher. Oh, My Papa.
Oh, Daddy couldn't stand that.
Rosemary Clooney, Hey There. Sure. She's on there twice. Kitty Callan, Little Things Mean a Lot. And look at here. We finally have a song that is almost rock and roll. Shaboom by the Crew Cuts. We're going to talk about that in the year 1955.
Shaboom, shaboom. Shaboom, shaboom. Well, I hope I'm sorry.
Doris Day. Secret Love, and this was the biggest song of 1954, the Cordettes, Mr. Sandman, and I thought I'd play that for you since it was such a big hit. I can remember hearing this song on the radio and playing the record that my mom had.
Magic beat.
By the way, folks, that was the not the only big song that the Cordettes had. They also, later on in 1958, had a hit record called Lollipop. You might remember that. And they were also the very first act to sing on American Bandstand when it went national in 1957. So they were pretty cool, okay? So let's talk about the King of Rock and Roll, Elvis. By the way, folks, he did not like that title. He did not believe that he ought to be called that. If you don't know, Elvis was a pretty religious person. And he often said there was only one king, and that was Jesus. There has always been generational shifts in artistic taste, often centered around a single charismatic figure. So Elvis was this huge charismatic figure, but folks, he wasn't the first one. That wasn't anything unusual. It started a long time ago, but you know, it definitely started in the 1800s with a man by the name of Franz Liszt, one of these classical music composers. He was a piano composer primarily. He produced such frenzy, bordering on actual hysteria, that they actually coined the term Listomania. His admirers, mainly young society women, would swarm over him. They'd fight over his handkerchiefs, his gloves. They would snip his locks of his hair. I've read where if he was out on the street and he dropped a bead of sweat, somebody would follow him and dip their handkerchief. Some woman would dip their handkerchief in his bead of sweat and keep it. I mean, he was just an idol to these people. Later on in the 1920s, during the jazz age, we saw almost the same amount of attention given to Josephine Baker, who hailed from St. Louis, but lived most of her life in Paris. And she was absolutely almost worshipped by European audiences. Was dubbed the Black Venus, the Creole goddess. And her performances at the Folies Bergères caused riots and swarming crowds. Of course, that was probably in part because she did most of her act without much clothes on, okay? Let's be honest. And then, of course, there was Rudolph Valentino, nicknamed the Latin Lover. I'm sure we've all heard of him. He caused such mass hysteria among his female fans that upon his death in 1926, when they had his funeral in New York City, there was 100,000 fans lined the streets of Manhattan to pay their respects. And there were actually reports of suicide. There are reports that some of his fans actually committed suicide. They were so aggrieved over the loss. So, and then of course, Frank Sinatra. I mean, remember his Bobby Soxers who swooned and swarmed over him. Much of they had Liszt caused riots to break out. The Beatles, you know, I mean, they had to finally give up touring live acts because of Beatlemania. It overwhelmed their music to the point that they would put on a concert and you couldn't hear them because there was so much screaming going on by the fans that there was no sense even going to their concert. Even today, folks, just now, Taylor Swift, who is probably the biggest music attraction there is going on in America right now, she literally broke the internet a couple of weeks ago when her concert tickets went on sale. They even had a congressional hearing about this thing. So folks, this is nothing new, but there is without a doubt, no one has produced quite the frenzy, quite the reaction that Elvis did when he first performed in his early years. So here's Franz Liszt. There's Josephine Baker. She's actually got a lot of clothes on for her act. There is Rudolph Valentino's funeral. There's Frank Sinatra getting off a train, being swarmed by his fans. Of course, Beatles. Remember the Beatlemania and Taylor Swift now. So how did Elvis single-handedly do all this? Well, his early performances, folks, were not so much about his music as it was his performance antics. I'll be honest, okay? His music was different, but it was his performance antics that got everybody riled up at first. That occurred at his very first stage performance in Memphis, July 17th, 1954. He was doing an outdoor conference concert in Memphis, Tennessee. I believe he opened for Slim Whitman. And he displayed for the first time what became known as his rubber legs. During the instrumental parts of his songs, Elvis would back away from his microphone, and partly in response to the rhythm, but mostly because of his nervousness, he began to shake his legs. And he wore these big, wide-cut, loose pants that weren't didn't have a lot of lining in them, and they just absolutely emphasized his movements. And the young women went crazy. By the way, Scotty Moore, who was one of his musicians that played with him, said he told them he thought they were making fun of him at first. He really was kind of upset because he didn't realize the kind of reaction that it was producing. Now, if you don't remember, there was a lot of people that were very upset with Elvis's antics in the first years. Jack Gould, the New York Times music critic, who was considered to be the kind of cultural guru of the age, wrote, "Mr. Presley has no discernible singing ability. His phrasing consists of sounds like a beginner's aria in a bathtub." Not very flattering. Ed Sullivan declared him unfit for family viewing. He said, "I'll never have him on my show." Well, of course, he would change his mind pretty fast when he realized how much money he was going to generate. Frank Sinatra obviously was feeling just a little bit threatened. He said Elvis sung music like a cretinous goon, almost imbecilic, with lewd lyrics that appealed to every sideburned delinquent on the face of the earth. So Frank Sinatra didn't have very much good to say about Elvis in the beginning. Of course, if you don't know, when Elvis finally got out of the army in 1959, it was Frank Sinatra's show that he first appeared on. And Frank paid out the ear to get him on there. Whoops, don't know what I did there. Okay. Hang on. I don't know what I'm doing here. There we go. I don't know what happened. Okay, so let me go back here. I hit the wrong button. Okay. One newspaper issued this review after one of his concerts in May of 1956. Elvis performed as if he was imitating a combination of Johnny Ray, Frank Sinatra, Marlon Brando, and a howling turpentine dog and a holy roller preacher. By the way, folks, that was a review in the Springfield newspapers when he performed his concert at the Shrine Mosque in May of 1956. Not exactly the most flattering comments, to say the least. He was decried by clergymen all over the United States. I mean, they've had sermon after sermon. They even appealed to the FBI to investigate him for corruption of morality. One of those was the Reverend Jimmy Snow, who, by the way, was the son of country music singer Hank Snow, who, by the way, was probably responsible in a large part for getting Elvis introduced to Colonel Parker and getting him on his first show at the Grand Ole Opry. But that's another story we'll get to. But let's listen to about a minute and a half clip of the Reverend Jimmy Snow preaching against rock and roll.
"These men come down here from New York and from Florida to find out my reasons on rock and roll music and why I preach against it, and I believe with all of my heart that it is a contributing factor to our juvenile delinquency of today. I 100% believe it. Why I believe that is because I know how it feels when you sing it. I know what it does to you. And I know the evil feeling that you feel when you sing it. I know the lost position that you get into in the beat. Well, if you talk to the average teenager of today and you ask them what it is about rock and roll music that they like, and the first thing they'll say is the beat, the beat, the beat."
Okay, so that was Reverend
Men come down
preaching against it. So how did all this happen? How in the world did Elvis get to the point where he created this hysteria amongst his fans and this absolute almost hatred from those that didn't like him? Well, let's go back and look, okay? Elvis Presley was born January the 8th, 1935, lived 42 years, died August 16th, 1977, born in the small town of Tupelo, Mississippi, which is about 100 miles southeast of Memphis, about 100 miles east of Clarksdale on the Stovall Plantation. Remember, that's where the Delta Blues were born. He was the son of Vernon and Gladys Presley. He had had a stillborn brother. He was a twin, and his brother died in childbirth. His name was Jesse Garron Presley. And the Presleys were really poor folks. They relied on government neighborly assistance much of their early life. They actually lived on the very edge of the Black neighborhood in Tupelo. It was called Shake Rag. And while he was an average student and he attended the white school, he was kind of considered to be white trash by his fellow classmates. You go back and they've done interviews with some of the people that went to school with him in Tupelo, and they just, you know, he was considered to be white trash. That's what they called him. He received a guitar on his 11th birthday and was taught to play, and honestly, not very well, by his two uncles and later on his pastor in Memphis. It's known that a local hillbilly singer by the name of Carvel Osborne, better known as Mississippi Slim, let Elvis sing on the Tupelo radio show that he had at least once. I think he sung Old Ship. That was one of the very first songs that Elvis remembered singing. Whether he was influenced at the time by the itinerant blues players that traveled through Tupelo, we really don't know, but there's probably a strong likelihood. He most certainly was influenced by the music he heard while attending his local Assembly of God church. But he was also known to sneak into the local Black juke joints, which was in Shake Rag. And we also know that he snuck in, or at least around the Black church that was there too. This was kind of a habit of his, even when he became a teenager in Memphis. By the age of 13 in 1948, the family basically was forced to move. They were so impoverished, and Vernon had to serve a 8-month jail term because he kited a check. He wrote, altered the amount of the check. And they felt like they needed to get out of Tupelo, and they felt like he needed to get away from this, you know, this crime that he had committed, and at the same time, better opportunities for employment in Memphis. So Elvis was 13 when they moved to Memphis, Tennessee. So if you were to go to Tupelo today, you would see this. This is, they have restored his shotgun house that Vernon built. Vernon built this house, just a 2-room house. And you can go there and see it today. They've completely restored it. This is a very early picture of Elvis with his mother and his father. This is one of the very earliest pictures we have of Elvis. Cute kid, say the least. And here's a picture of Elvis at about the time that he would have made the move to Memphis, Tennessee. Probably a little bit earlier, probably about 11 or 12 in Tupelo at that time. So if you've not seen the movie Elvis, the recent movie that's come out, it's a pretty good movie. I'll be honest, when I decided to watch it, I thought, well, I'm not going to like this because I didn't feel like I would. But it actually turned out to be a pretty good movie. There is one scene in there that I really like, and it's a scene that kind of shows the early influence of Elvis living in Tupelo in Shake Rag, and it kind of shows the influence of not just the Black church, but the Black juke joints, and how it must have influenced his later on career. So let's look at this short clip here from the new Elvis movie that came out about a year ago.
Jesse, Elvis's twin brother, who died at birth. Tragic.
Come quick, it's another trial.
My darling, you'll have the strength of two men.
But when my boy's daddy passed a bad check and got carted off to prison,
oh,
The boy and his mama had to take one of the houses for white folks in a colored neighborhood. But that boy had a big imagination. He really believed he was the hero in one of them comic books. He was going to bust his daddy out of the hoosegow and fly him to the rock of eternity.
Then he buys his mama a pink Cadillac.
Pink Cadillac? What you talking about?
I fool!
Come on, Doc, let's go.
Them comic book heroes all have them superpowers. His was music.
You gotta get on in. They've already announced you on the radio.
Folks are real excited.
At Sun Records, Sam Phillips was on a mission to save the world by recording black music. But it didn't sell. So to pay his bills, he needed to find a new singer for his country act.
I don't know what it is you see in this boy.
I just think he's different.
How do you know Big Boy Crudder?
That's all right, Mama. That's all right with you. That's all right, Mama. Any way you do, that's all right. That's all right. That's all right.
Okay, so I love that clip because it shows the influence of both the black rhythm and blues, the jump blues. By the way, that was Big Boy Arthur Crudup singing in the jute joint there, That's All Right, Mama. And it also shows the influence of you know, the religious gospel music that had a great influence upon Elvis. So I like that clip for that reason. Well, the family got to Memphis, 1948. And they got a place living in what was called the Lauderdale Courts, which was a government-assisted housing unit. Actually, it was pretty good compared to what they'd been living in. They actually were in a pretty good place. Elvis attended high school, Hume High School, same high school that Donna Shore attended, several other big important people that grew up in Memphis. He was described as an average student. He only failed one class in school. Music. Can you believe it? He failed music, kind of like Albert Einstein failing mathematics when he was in the fourth grade or something like that. He was often bullied and teased by the cool kids as a mama's boy and a weirdo. Again, they've gone back and they've researched people who went to school with him and asked him what they thought about Elvis at the time. And these are some of the kind of quotes that came out. He was a mama's boy. He was a weirdo. By the age of 15, he began to be tutored some more by a neighbor and by his pastor on the guitar. And he actually had improved enough that he was actually kind of playing around the Lauderdale course with a couple of other of his residents that lived there. By his junior year in high school, Elvis had totally changed himself. Before that, he had kind of dirty blonde brown hair, but he absolutely idolized Robert Mitchum and Tony Curtis. So he decided to grow his hair, dye his hair black. He grew his hair in a ducktail. He let his sideburns grow out. He even began to put on black eyeliner, eyeshadow under his eyes. You can look at early pictures of Elvis, and you can see he's got that black eyeliner under his eyes. He began to wear really flashy clothes. He loved black and pink. That was his favorite colors, and that was big colors later on amongst some of the boys and girls in the 1950s. During his senior year, he participated in the high school talent show. He actually did well enough that kids kind of began to change their mind about him. Some of the cool kids began to kind of accept him a little bit. Out of high school, he became a local truck driver, working for an electric company, making deliveries all over the city of Memphis. But his dream was to become a singer and really, folks, a movie star. Singing was just a way in the beginning for Elvis to reach movies. That's what he wanted to be, was a movie star. And obvious, he wanted to escape the poverty. That was his way. He just felt like that was the best way he could get out of the poverty. So here is Lauderdale Courts, where he grew up in Memphis, spent his high school years. This was Hume High School, where he went to high school. And this is a picture of Elvis. I believe he would have been, this was about his junior year of high school. You can tell his hair is not dyed yet. He's not dyed his hair black. It's still got that dirty blonde tint to it. By the way, that photograph is hanging in Graceland. If you were to go to Graceland, if you have been, you probably remember that big picture of Elvis hanging in the living room there. So who were his early musical inspirations? Well, in the beginning, they were country music players. People like Hank Snow, Roy Acuff, Ernest Tubb, Bob Wills, Texas Playboys, Western Swing, Texas Swing. He was also deeply affected by gospel music. He absolutely loved Jake Hess. He said that he was his favorite singer growing up, and he actually influenced this ballad singing style. We've seen how he absolutely adored the Blackwood Brothers, and who, again, attended the same church that he went to. He also went to the regular monthly all-night gospel singings in Memphis, where nationally known gospel groups, both black and white, performed. And it was here that he first heard Sister Rosetta Tharpe. Remember that black lady that sang gospel songs and played the guitar like, Jimi Hendrix. she was unbelievable. And one of his girlfriends, who he had during his high school years, said he consistently snuck off to the local Black Assembly of God church in his neighborhood and would listen to the music from outside. He felt more in tune with the Black experience than a lot of people did at that time. So I thought I'd play this film clip. This is Jake Hess and the Imperials. This would have been who Elvis would have idolized. By the way, there's four members here, and you'll see them in a minute. Jim Murray, you can still see singing on some of the Gaither videos, if you're a fan of the Gaither videos. There was Gary McSpadden, this guy here, who, by the way, is still living and is performing and has a ministerial show down in Branson, Missouri. And then there's Jake Hess, who died several years back. He was on a lot of the early Gaither videos. And then there was Armand Morales, who sang bass with the group. But this is... one of their songs that Elvis would have grew up listening to Jake Hess sing. And like I said, he absolutely idolized Jake Hess.
Well, next song is one of those happy songs, toe-tapping, hand-clapping spirituals, all about your first day in heaven.
Oh, it's a great, great morning, your first day in heaven, when you stroll down the golden avenue. There are mansions left and right, and you thrill every sight, and the saints are always smiling, saying, oh, it's a great, great morning, your first day in heaven, when you realize your worrying days are through. It's a great, great morning for you. I had a dream and I'll confess I hated to awake. He was an angel at the great pearly gate. St. Peter said, why, hello there, where have you been? We've got your mansion ready, so come right in.
And then he rang for an angel to act as a guide.
He's ready to swing the timer to our lucky fly. Oh, it's a great, great morning, your first day in heaven. When you stroll down the golden avenue, there are mansions left and right, and you thrill to every sight, and the saints are always smiling, saying, how do you do? Oh, it's a great, great morning, that first day in heaven, when you realize your worrying days are through. You'll be glad you were not idle, took time to read the Bible. It's a great morning, a great morning.
Okay, so that's where we're at. We are going to finish here today. Next week, we're going to pick up with Elvis walking in the Sun Studios in 1954, making his recording. And we're going to find out how it absolutely blew up. He became almost an overnight sensation, folks, and particularly in the southern part of the country. It was actually a little bit later before he got national wide attention, but It was something else. So that's where we're going to finish today. I hope you've enjoyed it. Hope you've learned a little bit of something about Elvis, and we will see you next week.